Hi, my name is Scott Markley. I'm the lead pastor here at First Baptist Church of Lake Wales. We are so thrilled that you are checking out this broadcast of our services here at First Baptist. We trust that you will encounter God this day as you watch the broadcast through dynamic worship and through His Word. May He minister to you this day.
Well, good morning, First Baptist. You notice it's a little bit lower in our attendance today because our men are in Metter and they're starting to make their way back. But we have our time of worship this morning, so go ahead and stand with us and let's sing our praises to the Lord together.
His love for me, who the
sing of the goodness of God.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I know you as a father. In the goodness of God.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will see the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you've been faithful. Of the goodness of God. Make that your prayer today, church.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able,
good morning. We are so glad you guys are here, even though it's slim because of matter. In your bulletin, if you are new here, there's the connection card, and just fill it out and put it in the offering plate as it goes around later. And this morning, if you will, greet one another and say hello to someone that is around you.
Thank you.
as you make your way back to your seats, we're going to sing No Longer Slaves, and just really take this time to think about how much God has done for us, how he has saved us, redeemed us, rescued us, and how we have freedom in him.
And you unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears have gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I've been born again to your family.
we don't praise, that the rocks are gonna cry out. And I don't want that to happen. I want us to be the one praising the Lord. So sing with us. All the earth will shout your praise.
Got a text. It was early this morning, and the text was from Scott, our pastor, and he said, "Brother, may the Spirit of the Lord be with you, and may you bless the church," and so forth. And I read it, and Vicki said, "We do have a pastor that cares about the church, don't we?" Indeed, we do, and that's a very good thing. I hope you all celebrate that. Well, since Scott's gone and he can't hold me accountable for this, it's just us girls, you know, the men. So I'm going to take shameful advantage and introduce to you a very distinguished visitor from Lakeland, Florida. You may have heard of it. His name is Asher. Asher, would you come up here for just a second? Now, look at him. Come on up here, young man. Our son David and his lovely wife Laura gave us Asher 10 years ago, in whom I am well pleased. I call him Grand Boy. Wasn't that awful shameful? When y'all get to preach, you can do the same thing. Well, let me see. You know, I really don't know how to get traction this morning. I don't know how to get going. So I'll just figure it out in just a second. Time changes. You know what I hate about the time changing? I have an electronic watch, and I don't know how to set it. So I fussed and fussed and fussed with that thing this morning. My salvation was intact, but my testimony was on the line. And they had more buttons and beeps and everything. I could not change it. So I reached in the drawer and I found a different kind of watch. And thankfully, apparently I hadn't used it since last year, so it's on the right time. Oh, anyhow, what else? When I was a kid, about Asher's age, I had an uncle named Leo. We were having a barbecue at our house in Alexandria, Virginia. You could see the monuments in D.C. from our backyard. And I didn't know how cool that was until now. It was just a matter of course then. We were having a barbecue, and my birthday was approaching, and my Uncle Leo came and sat beside me, and he said, "Eddie, what do you want for your birthday?" And I said, "I would love to go to a Washington Senators game." I had never been to a Major League Baseball game. I loved the sport, and I wanted to go. And my birthday came around, and I got an envelope, and I opened it up, and it was a passbook. On the front, it said, "The Knothole Club." Taken off of the old days of baseball when the fences were wooden and the stadium was wooden, and kids would take a little hammer and tap out the knothole in the plank, and then they'd look through it to see what was going on the inside. So my Uncle Leo, he was an FBI agent, and he was an athlete in his own right. That's why he did it. He had played football for the University of Virginia, and he had also played baseball for them. And that's where I started playing baseball for them. And he decided to bless me with that, but here was the deal. I couldn't go to these games unless he took me. It was a deal that the Senators worked out. They're now called the Nationals, by the way. They played pretty well. He had to take me to the game. And I couldn't pay for the tickets either. But there were about six of them in the Knothole Club until my Uncle Leo took me and paid the price for it. I couldn't get on the inside. There's another shameless taking advantage of today to bring baseball into it. But I think that there's a spiritual principle. I couldn't go unless he paid the price. I couldn't get in unless he took me. And he stayed with me through it. For this morning, we're in the book of Philemon. It's right before Hebrews. When you go to Hebrews, go to the left backwards, and you'll find Philemon. It's a very short book. As a matter of fact, it's only one chapter, and it only has 25 verses. In a moment, I think I'll read it. I've entitled this morning's message, "A Radical New Deal." A radical new covenant, if you would. A radical New Testament. We're going to see that and receive a teaching. The book of Philemon, I believe, is a beautiful story of brotherly love. It's a beautiful story of Christian diplomacy and the mixture, the wonderful mixture, the chemistry of grace and truth. It's a story of advocacy and mediation and grace. And in it all, I see the gospel. A radical new deal. Many of you remember years ago that America had a president bearing the name of Lyndon Baines Johnson. He crafted a new order for society. He called it the Great Society. It was a time of social reform and economic redistribution, and you know, we get our welfare from that now. And in any case, he was nobly intended, I guess. Years before that, there was another president bearing the name of Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He served four terms. He almost became a monarch. And he crafted another deal that he named the New Deal. Social reform, economic plans to get everybody on level footing and so forth, nobly intended. Centuries prior to Franklin Roosevelt and his New Deal, God came to earth. God came to earth in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. He was also, to me, Jesus of eternity. He came with a new message. A word from glory. A message from eternity regarding how it is that God sees man and how it is that man should see man and treat man if man desires godliness. Jesus shocked his audiences. Jesus broke ranks. I believe that he was a radical rabbi. He shocked his world in his choice of disciples. He shocked his world in his choice of friends. And he shocked the status quo in his choice of what audience he would take God's message to. Jesus had a disciple. A disciple that, by his own admission, was born out of due season. A disciple that did not regard himself worthy of being a disciple. He was, at first, very reluctant to get on board with the radical rabbi, Jesus of eternity. He bore the name Paul of Tarsus. But Paul did get on board. He got so on board that God honored him with the privilege of writing a full one half of the New Testament, a story of God's will. Let's break for just a moment. Can we pray for a moment the prayer of our Lord? Can we do it in unison and use the word debts instead of trespasses? It's equally as valid. Would you pray with me the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You can probably tell that I used to be a Catholic. But I think that the prayer of our Lord is very, very important, and I just felt a leading to do that. The book of Philemon, allow me, because it's so short, to simply read it this morning. Take a look at what's going on and take a look at the cast. The cast of characters is Paul of Tarsus writing to a man by the name of Philemon. Philemon was a Christian slave owner. Can you get your mind around that? No, because you live in the 21st century. But you could in the first century. A Christian slave owner. And then there is Onesimus. Onesimus was a runaway slave from Philemon who came into contact with Paul, and then Paul advocates, mediates, and pleads for Philemon to be received in a new way. Here it goes. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved friend and fellow laborer, to the beloved Apphia, Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God, making mention of you always in my prayers, hearing of your love and your faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and toward all the saints, that the sharing of your faith may become effective by the acknowledgement of every good thing which is in you, in Christ Jesus. We have great joy and consolation in your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed by you, my brother. Therefore, though I might be very bold in Christ to command you what is fitting, yet for love's sake, I rather appeal for you, to you, being such a one as Paul the aged, also now a prisoner of Jesus Christ. I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus, whom I have begotten while in chains, who once was unprofitable to you, but now he's profitable to you and to me. I am sending him back. You therefore receive him. That is my own heart, whom I wish to keep with me, that on your behalf he might minister to me in my chains in the gospel. But without your consent, I wanted to do nothing, that your good deed might not be by compulsion, as it were, but voluntary. Perhaps he departed for a while for this purpose. Maybe Onesimus left you and went on the run for this purpose in a day, a time such as this, that you might receive him forever. No longer as a slave. More than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, now much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. If then you count me as a partner, receive him as you would me. But if he's wronged you or owes you anything, put that on my account. I, Paul, am writing with my own hand. I will repay, not to mention to you that you owe me even your own self besides. Yes, brother, let me have joy from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in the Lord. Having confidence in your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. Meanwhile, prepare a guest room for me. I trust that through your prayers, I shall be granted to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Jesus Christ, greets you, as do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, Luke, my fellow laborers. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with you. In your spirit, amen. Quite a letter, isn't it? Philemon is an amazing contribution to the New Testament, in my view. Did you hear Paul's very courteous, very discreet appeal for a new understanding of human relationships? This speaks, I think, it shouts through the ages. The author is Paul. That first century intellectual rabbi who pulled in the poles of his ancient world and he hung them on the cross. As far as Paul was concerned, when he became a believer, the cross was everything. Everything. The resurrection, that undeniable fact of his time, a similar everything. He was on board with the Lord Jesus. He was the early church's most dangerous prosecutor, but he became the eternal church's greatest preacher. With frenzied pen, he wrote, setting the record straight, passing on to us theology, codifying God's will. And when Paul wrote to Philemon, he was writing for all of us, something to be learned by all Christians of all ages, that being how it is that we should regard, how it is that we should treat, and how it is that we should treasure God's people. This book is there in the canon of the New Testament because we need it. There is something to learn indeed. Remember that the author is Paul, but the authority is God. Secondly, I want to point out to you his appeal, his standing for Onesimus, the runaway slave. Paul said in the 9th verse and the 10th verse, I appeal to you, Philemon, for my son, Onesimus, who I have begotten in my chains. Met him in jail, if you would. Hear me, Philemon. I am advocating for both you and for him. And I am mediating for Onesimus. That's a name we're not familiar with. He is my son. What an interesting choice of words to describe the relationship. Paul used that same choice of words to describe his relationship to Timothy. My son. My son's here today, David. That's an endearing term. That is Paul's opening salvo. And listen, Paul is at the very top of society. A rabbi, a Pharisee of Pharisees, almost no doubt that he sat on the Sanhedrin, their Supreme Court, very intellectual, a scholar, spoke many languages, and as a result of his position, he was no doubt compensated very well. He was probably very wealthy. So he's at the top of society any way that you cut it. And Onesimus is a runaway slave. He's at the very bottom of society. They probably shared a jail cell. And Paul won him to Jesus. Paul says to Philemon, I want you to receive him. That's in the 12th verse. I want you to value him. That's in the 13th verse. See him as I see him, as a partner. And I see him as family. Did you know that if you love Christ, you are family to everyone else who loves Christ? In a land far away, in a time long ago, I was with an organization called the Pittsburgh Pirates. I was a decent pitcher, but I never got beyond the minor leagues. We had a first baseman by the name of Willie Stargell. And Willie Stargell liked Sister Sledge. And Sister Sledge sang a song, We Are Family, something like that. We are family. And they started putting that on the PA at Three River Stadium. And Willie Stargell was over there on first base dancing. Then Bill Mazeroski on second base started dancing. Gene Alley and Richie Hebner and Matty Alou and Roberto Clemente and Manny Sangui and everybody started dancing to We Are Family. The people started drifting into the aisles and they started dancing with each other to We Are Family. Okay, that's neat. That's nice. But they weren't. Lots of people call themselves family. The Cosa Nostra, they call one another brother. Genuine family is when we share together the same eternal Father. We share together the same promise of an eternal future. That means gentlemen that are left behind by the exodus to Medar, you are my brothers. Gentle ladies, you are my sisters, and we are family. Paul said, Onesimus is now my son. That's how I see it. And he begged Philemon to accept him. No longer as a slave, but as a brother. A brother in the Lord, same father, same future, same family. Onesimus was a born-again man. He had realized Jesus Christ. He had confessed his sin. He had welcomed Christ into his heart and into his life. And Onesimus became a new creature, where the old things were gone and everything was new. He was a redeemed man now, a former runaway slave. Now he's family. Christian people belong to the Lord for certain, but Christian people belong to one another equally as certain. Onesimus was accepted in heaven, and the appeal is for the church on earth to accept him as well, what is already done in heaven. Now I know why I was led to do the Lord's Prayer, because part of that prayer is, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, is it not? Let's see it the way that heaven sees it. Let's do it the way that heaven would have us do it, treasuring one another. Wouldn't it be something if we regarded and treasured and accepted and forgave one another on earth, responding to thy will be done. And it became that way. I'll tell you, the kingdom of God would be so attractive, so desirable, that folks would be lined up at the door trying to get in. Young men who thought that the best thing in the world would be to be in a fraternity at a college or university would realize the mistake of that. That the fraternity is not helpful, it's harmful. Young women would realize that the sorority has nothing to offer. Adults would realize that the fraternal clubs around, you know, they might do something. They might do some things together, you know, the moose and the mice and the eagles and, you know, everyone else. Good night, the VFW, the American Legion. What am I leaving out? Masons. They'd all realize that they all come up short, nobly intended, but falling short of genuinely being family. All the isms of the world, you know, Taoism, Confucianism, Buddhism, Hinduism, Mohammedism, Sikhism, they all come up short. And they would all dry up. Islam would dry up for lack of fertile ground. Because the church of the Lord Jesus would be so attractive because they love one another. And they stand for one another. And they stand beside one another. And they cover one another's sick. And they weep with those that weep and rejoice with those that rejoice. It can be that way. It should be that way. And when it becomes, we will not have to have a program for evangelism. It'll be automatic. Track with me here. There's one third issue that I'd like to bring up this morning. That's an issue of accountability. Verses 18 and 19. If he has wronged you, Philemon, if he owes you anything, put it on my account. I'll pay the debt. Friends, that is godliness 101. That is basic Christ-likeness. I'll pay his debt. That is selflessness put boldly on display by the Holy Spirit. That is a sacrificial spirit put boldly on display. That is substitutionary debt relief put boldly on display. And that is precisely what Jesus did for us on that cross. The old song talks about he paying a debt he did not owe because we had a debt we could not pay. We needed someone to wash our sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace. You all remember that? Christ Jesus paid a debt that he did not owe. There's words something like that. The theology is sound, it's good. The great discriminator is that genuinely only God in a body could assume the sin debt of the entire world for all time. But the question is, do you think it's a stretch to say that Christian people ought to be willing to stand by, stand for, stand behind one another as family? Jesus said, greater love has no man than he who lays down his life for the brethren. That's a wonderful brace of scripture that's included in many funerals, and it should be. It ought to be included in our lives as basic Christ-likeness. It's just the way that we live. Some years ago, about 9 or 10 years ago now, I was honored to represent you, taxpayers. You paid my salary. You paid Jim's salary every time you burned up all that fuel in an F-15. You paid for us to do what we did, and many of you. But I was a chaplain of the back half of my career to the special operations community. I worked for an organization called SOCOM, United States Special Operations Command. While there, I had the distinct privilege of being a part of a ceremony of a couple of Medal of Honor winners, posthumous, Michael Murphy and Michael Mansour. Michael Murphy was a SEAL, a lieutenant, same as an Army captain or Marine Corps captain. And he was a team leader for the SEALs. There was a movie, Soul Survivor, that was made about it. There was one who survived this ambush, Marcus Luttrell. This was Marcus's boss, Michael Murphy. They were caught, surprised by the strength of the Taliban on a mountaintop in Afghanistan. They were completely cut off. They were surrounded. The Taliban had overwhelming firepower and overwhelming numbers. While pinned down, they tried with their standard table of equipment, with their satellite phone, to reach to the skies where there were Rangers and utility helicopters always on patrol in the air, ready to rescue a unit that might get in trouble and get over their head. So they're trying to radio out to get the Rangers to come in, probably about 60 of them, to change the odds a bit. The satellite phone would not reach out because of the terrain, the mountains. Michael Murphy saw a clearing and he said to his radio telephone operator, I'm told, if I can get over there, I can transmit. His RTO said, if you try to go over there, you won't last a minute. Murphy said to him as he started to run to the clearing to try to get the Rangers to come in and save them. He said, yes, but if I can last a minute, he could get the signal out to get rescue. If I can live one more minute, you can be saved. And he ran to that clearing and he got the signal out and the bullets started hitting him. His last words on this earth were over the radio to the Rangers, thank you. And then he succumbed to his wounds. I was in a ceremony where he and Mansour were being inducted into the Special Operations Hall of Fame, and their names would be inscribed in the black granite walls in Tampa in this memorial park that's built in the shape of the tip of a spear, which means first in and last out. Tip of the spear is first in and last out. It's the same symbol I wear on this, very proudly to have been associated with such people. And everybody was there. The politicians were there, you know. The command was there. A whole host of four-star generals and admirals and lieutenant generals and major generals. I mean, they were all there. And as I prayed at the end of that ceremony, the Navy band started playing very softly and the Navy singers started singing Eternal Father, God to Save, the Navy hymn. I prayed in thanksgiving for that greater love that was put on display by Michael Murphy. After it was over, his dad, who had been the commandant of the SEAL school in Coronado Island, California, he got up and he walked right by all the politicians and all the four stars and such that wanted to speak to him. And he walked right to me, standing in a lectern like this one. Tears were rolling down his face. He was a SEAL in his own right and a commander. And he hung on my shoulders and he said, I never understood until today. I never understood that my son was giving his life that others might live. I was always mad And now I understand that is nobility. And I am freed. That's what he said. My boss, a four-star admiral, highest ranking SEAL ever, was standing to the side and looking on, and he heard it all. And what a beautiful thing. That was the word of God reaching through the ages. Michael Mansour, do you have another slide here? With what a rascal, Petty Officer Michael Mansour. He was on a rooftop in Iraq with other SEALs. It was a sniper position. A fake Iraqi soldier got up to the rooftop with a satchel charge. And Mansour looked at the other SEALs on the rooftop. They looked at him, and he dove on the satchel charge, absorbing the blast in his body to save others. It was deliberate, sacrificial, loving suicide. Where do we get people like that? Oftentimes we get them from the pews. They go from the pews to patrol. Oftentimes they just come from the street and from the universities and see you as important. And they'll pay the price. They will pay the price so that we can sleep peaceably in our beds at night. That's just a human example of sacrificial living and even dying. Let me give you another human example. His name was Moses. He came down from the mountaintop carrying the Ten Commandments. He must have been really excited. I mean, no one else had them. God gave them to Moses. He had been at the burning bush. He had heard the voice of God. He knew that he was the great I am. And Moses is all pumped up, no doubt. I can't wait to get down and tell Aaron. I can't wait to get down and tell the children of Israel. And he comes off the mountainside, and what does he see? The children of Israel, led by Aaron, worshiping a golden calf. Moses was so crestfallen, you can imagine. And he cried out, oh God, forgive them. But Lord, if you cannot forgive them, then take my name out of the book of life. Did you hear that? Let me be banned from glory that they might be forgiven. Wow. He wasn't alone. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Roman church, he said, 9th chapter Romans, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, that I have continual heaviness and sorrow in my heart for my brethren according to the flesh. For I could wish that I myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren. I would take the curse and the banishment, dear God, if they would come to you. Of course, he couldn't. Moses couldn't. Moses looked to a Redeemer who could, and Paul looked back to a Redeemer who did, and his name is wonderful. Counselor, mighty God. Everlasting Father. The offer of Jesus is, I'll pay your debt. Regardless of how deep the stain, regardless of your sin resume, I'll pay the debt. Will you accept it? I was doing a chapel service once, and there was a JAG officer, that's a military lawyer. He was on the front row, and he was shaken. I mean, he was under such amazing conviction. When the service was over, I went back to my office with an assistant, and I said, boy, did you notice the JAG? He said, did I ever? And about that time, here comes the JAG officer into my little area. He said, Chaplain, let me talk to you. I'm at your service. He said, listen, I listened to that where you were talking about the forgiveness of God Almighty possible through Jesus, and I believe it. Oh my gosh, do I believe it? I said, have you accepted him? He said, I can't. I said, tell me why. Mr. Attorney, please tell me why. He said, because, Chaplain, I'm a lowlife. I'm a bottom dweller. I have broken every trust that's ever been placed in me by the state, by the nation, by the army, by my wife, by my children. I've lied to everybody, and I've broken every trust. I've even lied to my girlfriends about my wife and to my wife about my girlfriends. He said, I am a bottom dweller. And I said, so? He said, so, I'm beyond salvation. I said, Mr. Attorney, the evidence is overwhelming against you. But how dare you say that you're so special, that you're so far gone, that you're beyond the power of Christ Jesus? And he said he couldn't save anyone like me. I've been to Sunday school. I said, oh. So you've heard of Moses? And he said, yes, I know of Moses. You've heard of the Apostle Paul? Yes, I know of the Apostle Paul, New Testament now. I said, yes, you've heard of the great King David? He said, back to the Old Testament, I got it. I know that stuff. I said, do you know what they all had in common? And he said, yes, they were all great spiritual leaders. I said, they were. They were all also murderers. Do you have that on your resume? That probably shakes some of you to hear that Moses was a murderer, Paul was a murderer, King David was a murderer. Indeed they were. And then they found grace. And they found forgiveness. And they became great. The JAG officer said, no, I can't go there. The offer of Jesus is, I will pay your debt. To every aching heart that's sick of sin. The message of Christ is, my blood is sufficient. The cross is adequate. And I will accept the sin penalty on your behalf. Dear friends, we are Onesimus. We're just a group, bunch of people that ran away from God, and then some of us met the Lord, and then we turned our backs on the tyranny of sin, and we turned our faces and our lives toward the sweet embrace of spiritual liberty and forgiveness and the promise of life eternal. We're just Onesimus. That's all that we are. But our King is not only a King, he's the King of Kings. And our Lord is not only a Lord, he's the Lord of Lords. And if God be for us, it matters not who's against us. And God will indeed be for us. When we're for his plan and we're for his man. All hail the power of Jesus' name. I tell you, I am really glad to be adopted by the Holy Spirit into the family of God. I really kind of dig being forgiven. I love being forgiven. Do you? And I love being family. Yeah, I'll dance with you. I love being family. I love the bride of Christ. He paid a debt he did not owe because we had a debt we could not pay. God bless you each. Can we pray together? And Matt will come and he'll be with me, I think. I hope. You're the sole survivor. Everyone else is gone, brother. Listen. If the Lord is impressing any decision on your heart, such as joining a wonderful church, hey, do it today. And you might think, well, I don't have to do that publicly. Well, that's the devil. That's the hiss of the serpent. Jesus said, if we confess him before men, he'll confess us before the Father, which is in heaven. Maybe you're a full-fledged adult and you've never been baptized as a convert to Christianity. Jesus was a full-fledged adult when he was baptized by John the Baptist. That's one way of standing up publicly and saying, I do. It's like being married to the King of Kings. I do. I will, I shall, and I'll do it with other like-minded persons. Or maybe you've just realized that you're not beyond the grasp. Once I baptized a 101-year-old lady who made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. There's nobody beyond the grasp. The cross is enough. The blood is sufficient. And he loves us as we are. He does not change us in order to love us. He loves us in order to change us. It starts with his love toward us. Father, thank you for this time. It's a regal time. This is holy ground. And this is a kairos moment. It's so special. It's so strategic. I pray that as you search our hearts, you see hearts that are yielding to church membership, to baptism, to coming to faith in Christ by confessing sin and need and making declaration to serve Jesus. Jesus is Lord, and we believe that. That's what we're all about, Father. Swell our ranks, I pray, with boldness and public decision. I pray in the name of Jesus, who boldly and publicly hung on a cross for us. Lord, hear our prayer. Amen. Amen. Here for you, if there's a prayer request that you might have, Matt will be as well. And if you have nothing to decide, stand and let's sing praises to the one.
The storm, louder and
Amen. We're going to have the ushers go ahead and come forward as we prepare to continue our worship through our tithes and our offering.
I don't know how you made it up here. An obstacle course. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, as we sit here and worship with song this morning, as we worship with the Word of God, as we were blessed to the point of overflowing, Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for these men that we've heard about. We thank you for the blessings that we've heard about. We thank you for the love that we've heard about. And Lord Jesus, we just thank you for that gift of eternal life that we heard about, and that forgiveness of sins. Oh Lord, we're so humbled at the fact that you could forgive Moses, that you could forgive David, that you could forgive Paul. And Lord, some of us are just like them. So, Lord, we just ask you to forgive us and fill us with that sweet, wonderful Holy Spirit. Lord, take these tithes and offerings that we're giving and use them to glorify your name. In your name we pray. Amen.
Joyful. It's like a whole world to them, because for the first time they have received this precious gift.
Operation Christmas Child gives our church an opportunity to touch the world.
It's a great adventure to evangelize.
You've got an army of volunteers that pack the boxes
that are helping OCC to take the gospel literally to millions of children.
This is the Good Samaritan work that the Lord is looking for people to do.
Getting people locally to think globally.
What I love about OCC is that they are intentional about pouring into the lives of kids.
They receive a box and also an invitation to come back and learn more about Christ.
We just don't want to just hand out a box and stop there. We want them to grow in their faith.
It's a great tool, an effective tool to reach communities with the gospel of Jesus.
It's exciting to get people to heaven, but it's also exciting to get heaven to people.
That's our opportunity coming November 18th and then through the 25th is to take one of these boxes, take them home and fill them up and then bring them back the 18th through the 25th. That's Operation Christmas Child. So we have set these out here for you. Don't let any one box be left here. Take all of them. If you have multiple people in your family, like if you have two or three children, maybe take two or three boxes so that we can definitely minister to those people that are in our world. I know that they go into Guatemala, they go into Brazil, places where we go as a church. And so I'm looking forward to what we'll do as a church with Operation Christmas Child. Let me point a couple more things out in your worship guide before Charles comes and closes us in prayer. Is Faith Finders started on Tuesday, and it's going to continue this coming Tuesday. They still need a little bit of help. So if that's you, that you could offer up about an hour and a half on a Tuesday afternoon at Hillcrest, we would love for your help. You can call or text Lynn Hooten if you're available, and it would be helping out. I believe Barry told me, I said on Wednesday, I said, how did it go? And he said there were so many children that were there. And these children are hearing the good news, the gospel, where they may not hear it any other time. But I love that our church goes into the school and shares the gospel every Tuesday. So if you want to be a part of this, contact Lynn. We could desperately need your help. Also, you see in the worship guide that there is deacon nominations that happened, and the deacons that have not been ordained as deacons are going to give their testimony. And you see their names in there, Juan and Quinn, and Gene has been nominated. So we want to listen to their testimony. It's going to be this Wednesday coming at 6 o'clock in the fellowship hall. So come and be a part of that. And then on the screen, you see the guys from Metter. I got this text this morning or late last night from Charles. And there is a bunch of guys right there in red. It looks like red shirts. Are those red? Those are red. Thank you for my help there. They are on their way back. And so be praying for those guys as they come back. Yearly trip. And if you don't know what Metter is, that's a town in Georgia that they go to, a small town in Georgia named Metter. And they come together, just a bunch of guys get together, and they cook, they eat, they play games, and then they have a speaker, and they listen to God's word, and they listen to God's heart, and they come back home different and changed. So we're looking forward to them. Be praying for them to come back. So Charles, come and pray. Would everybody please stand?
I don't know about you, but I love this family. I'm glad I'm part of this family. Thank you, Brother Ed, for that sermon. Thank you so much. We needed that. I pray that each one of you will go back and do something good for somebody in this family this week. Reach out. Make a little sacrifice for somebody. It may be unexpected. But again, I love this family, and thank you. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this family, and we're a family because of you. Because we know you personally, you have put our names in the Lamb's Book of Life, and it'll be there forever. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for this family. And our family that's traveling south now from Metter, Georgia, give them safety. They'll come back to us safely, that they can continue to serve and worship here with us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for forgiveness. And Lord, just help us to go out and show others that you live in us, and they can see that because of our actions. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you for watching this broadcast today of services from First Baptist Church in Lake Wales. We trust that you met with God as you watched the broadcast. And now may you know his blessings as you walk in obedience to his word.